Thank you for coming back and thank you for staying with us. According to Chief Simon Adebo, a seasoned Nigerian civil servant, every problem has its roots in the past. And the past survives in the present. The present is indeed the past undergoing modification. Yet, as important as this is, in 2009-2010 academic session, history as a subject was expunged from the primary and secondary school curriculum. In 2017, the Nigeria Education Research and Development Council announced that it was set to reintroduce history as a subject, beginning from 2018 to 2019 academic session. Even at this, what is being covered? Who is telling our story? Can history in our primary and secondary schools go beyond current affairs? Please let us hear what you have to say. Remember, you can join the conversation. Tweet at us at WaysShowAfrica1 with the hashtag WaysShow or SMS or WhatsApp to 081-8038-4663. So now we have really come to talk about this. And let me just start with, you know, a simple question to both of you. Did you ever learn history in school? And by school, I mean primary, secondary school, early days.
Okay, primary school, yes, I did. Secondary school, yes, I did, for one term. Then after that, it was expunged. So that aspect of them saying 2009, I think that's a farce.
Maybe that's the official record. And your school just decided to junk it before they actually stopped.
Nah, I don't think so. Because at the time, I don't want anybody guessing my age.
But, it's fine, you're 15.
In this case, back in the 80s, late 80s, we didn't do, I think we just did it for one term back then in GSS, and afterwards it was eradicated. We didn't do it at all. And not that we even talked about the history of Nigeria or family history or tradition and stuff like that. And so we talked about oral tradition, Stone Age, early men,
wow,
and things about the future,
wow,
how the evolution of man, basically. So
I thought the evolution of man belonged in science.
Oh, Nigeria curriculum.
Wow.
For you.
So, I think for me, we did current affairs. And you know, if you were one of those students who was always going for quiz competitions and all of that, you would definitely have to learn current affairs. And then I think from GSS 1 to GSS 3, we had social studies. And it wasn't like they went in depth. It was basically Independence Day. Where was the date?
It's
when
so
was the first war? Mm. When was this? When was that? So those are the things you had to cram before.
Recall there used to be these little pamphlets of even then,
yeah,
when you want to go get a job,
yeah, mm-hmm,
at some point you have to know the commissioners,
mm-hmm,
yes, you have to know.
If you travel in buses, you will have them.
They always say, current affairs, teach your children.
But the key thing here is that our heritage as individuals, we need to understand where we are coming from. We need to know our values. Sometimes you see children sitting down talking in English throughout without knowing a word in their mother tongue. It still stems from our roots. It still stems from our heritage. It still stems from our history. How well do we know our history? Like we were talking earlier, you said something about us not knowing our heritage. If we go back to the village, do we actually know the core of where we are from,
exactly,
the history of our village? We do not know all of this. Look at back then, what's his name? If we had the thing of oral tradition, for example, whereby we had to transfer information
from
word of mouth.
Exactly.
Basically, we would have been able to have an idea. But in this day and age where we do not have a grandmother sitting under the...
our grandmothers are playing.
Sitting under the moonlight with a tree just right behind her, tells about the days of old. Then we used to, when we were kids, we had things like Tales by Moonlight, where we had things that they told us
did
stories.
They still tell stories about the tortoise?
Oh, yes. The fables. Oh, yes, they do. But
so
the
now,
key thing,
in schools?
Oh, yes. It's so important.
But let's go to the... Okay, let me allow you to finish.
But the key thing is this, that we do not have any of this anymore. And the earlier we try to go back to the basics and the roots of every tradition or every lineage, you get to know who we really are and have an idea of where we are going. And another thing is this, that let's take an example from the book Roots by Alex Haley. Okay?
Yeah.
Alex Haley did something that was so fantastic. He was able to get his roots from oral tradition, right from Kunta Kinte when he left Gambia, and he told the story to Kizzy, and you know, towards till it got to the door.
But
of Alex Haley.
Ify, thank you for that. And I would also want to add, it's a my daughter is in primary school, and she can tell you about the Great London Fire.
Okay.
And tell you about how many houses were burnt, the casualties, the day it happened, how long it took for that fire to go out. Now, and that is her in Nigeria learning about that. And that was because someone captured that history and that story. Because the power of history actually lies with the storyteller. So who is telling our story? Who is collecting that story? Jennifer, you want to say something?
Yeah, so I think the main problem, one of the reasons why we're not being taught these things growing up, is because history wasn't properly documented. Now, the truth is, if you actually want to know what happened back then, you have to talk to your great-great-great-grandfathers, great-grandfathers, great-grandmother. Well, they're not here. How many of them remember what happened to
but
them?
But those people don't talk to them, their great-grandfather or great-grandmother, because these things, as you said, they were documented, they were recorded. But do we think, let's just come back, do we think that in trying to, for maybe political interests, ethnic interests, that we're not capturing history and putting it in books where we're supposed to pass it on? Do you think that this is the case?
Even if we do capture it, they are distorted.
Yeah, no, we cannot argue that fact. History has always, the power of history has always lived with the storyteller.
Yeah.
Okay, but I think that even as historians collect history, there are some facts like science, you have to prove that, you know, these things happen.
Actually happen.
But what I am saying is that, you know, do we think that all this political blow, tribalism, blow us from recording our history and sharing it?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah. I think if because it wasn't properly documented, a lot of people don't know what to believe, who to... Okay, let's talk about politics, for example. Who to vote for. You see somebody who has ruled 20, 30 years ago, and he was a very terrible president. And then he's back here, he's contesting, and somehow you feel and believe that he's going to do better, and you are voting for him. Why?
So that resulted from not knowing.
Not knowing.
Because, you know, when we were giving our introductory speech, we talked about there have been 7 coups, you know, within the period that I had mentioned, from 1966 to about 1993. Okay. Now, the only way we even know military administrators growing up in school was the year and the period in which they ruled. Now, who is collecting the activities and the things that happened during their rule? What was their influence? What role did they play? What did they do? What were the benefits of, or what were the disadvantages of such? Because I'm thinking that if we know, and these are documented, and they do not just come out when there's a political, somebody who wants to occupy a political position, so you now use it against your opponent. But if they've been there and we have been reading about it, I think that there's some decisions that we make in this country that we will never take.
I would say this, that history has a way of coming back to us.
Exactly.
Especially, like you said, if we had known in the past that this was what happened, we would try to avoid the same mistakes that led to what must have led to what must have happened in the past. And that is, let's take the fact that history is a recording of past events.
Yes, it is.
Right?
Which is
now,
it?
These past events, how often do we have the proof of these past events? And that is what has led us to where we are today as a nation in Nigeria, that we do not have valid proof of what has transpired.
Who our historians are, yeah.
You know, in the past, we only know the surface stories.
Or what we Google on Wikipedia. Yeah.
Exactly.
let me say something for example.
Yes.
Let me say something for example. So, something that happened recently, last year, ENSA's protest.
Exactly.
And then we realized that 2 weeks after, or a day after, The whole event was fabricated. Mm-hmm. Now, we all saw what happened live. But what was being published in the news was totally different. Now, we're referring to history or back then, who documented it and all of that. Now, if you go online, you see there are different stories out there. Who is documenting this now? Now, we are in the present. Exactly. When our great-grandkids come, we'll be in the past.
Yes.
Whatever has happened now is going to be our past. It's going to be their past. And then we'll tell them, oh, this is what happened. But is there a particular place they can go to actually get the real and true story?
Now, after how many years, we talked about, look at the event that happened with, I think, the Biafran War.
Yeah, the Nigerian Civil War.
Now, currently, we have issues on ground between the East and Nigeria, in quote. So we do not have documented history of what had transpired.
We have different stories from different sources.
And the Biafrans at the time. But today, we have people who have accounts, personal accounts, that they what they encountered. I know for one that my mother's friend lost about 7 children to the war at the time. So look at different, all the stories, you bring them together and form a story, basically, that is history. We do not have all this in one place. Hmm. Look at our museums as well. Our museums are practically
I was even going to come to that, and I was going to talk about it under the topic or under, try to couch it under, how do we collect history? So how do we collect history? Who is recording history? Mm-hmm. So you talk about museums, and I know that we have museums in different parts of the country.
Absolutely.
But do our children even go for excursions in museums? They go to the airport.
They visit a bank. Water parks.
But they don't go to the
radio
museums.
Stations.
Mm-hmm. Why is this so? Why are we so detached as a people? But our children can tell you of monuments from all over the world. But we cannot go to a museum. If we see, so there's this very popular effigy in Edo State. I have forgotten the name.
It's very Queen popular. Idia.
Exactly. It's very popular. Mm-hmm. What do we know about it? You know what? These are artifacts that are celebrated in different
in all over the world. Actually,
exactly. But what do we know about it? You see how I was struggling with the name. You see how to remind.
That's
me.
Why it was used as the face of Festac 77.
Exactly. I don't know the history behind that, and I won't lie to you. I don't know the history. I don't know why it became so important. And this is what we're talking about. So in those places that we're collecting, even the little that we're collecting, the museums, how are they being funded?
Nobody knows. Nobody knows, because practically we have pushed culture behind and embraced Western traditions.
Okay.
And in the process, our culture, our tradition, our mother tongue, everything has been.
Some people say that religion has a part to play in this. So do you think that please share your thoughts with us why you think that religion also is a part.
And aside that, I think also during the amalgamation and when the whites came into our land to, you know, the whole slave trade and how we fought slave trade and we went from being slaves to being normal human beings and being in control and in charge of our lives and our economy and all of that. Now, when the whites came in, I feel like they introduced a lot of their own culture to us.
Through religion.
And because of slave trade, there are lots of things that people were hanging on to. Mm. Mm. So I feel like in a way you can't 100% blame us. Yeah, although we have a role to play, but when you have nothing else to live for, and you're seeing something, oh, let me hang on to this. I feel like this is my saving grace, or this would help me. Then you would leave what you know, you would leave your background, you leave your own culture, and move into something else that seems more comfortable for you. But yes, it actually has it has a
role. So if you let me just take this, because I want us to really dwell on that. So someone earlier today, before the show actually started, when they saw the topic for today, was saying that they were eagerly waiting for us. And he shared something with us. He said, without your own cultural identity, you become anything that they tell you that you are. Do we see this playing out? Because you just mentioned of how under the guise of religion, some of the things that or some of the practices that we have been condemned as not being right, as being dark. Okay.
Should I take that?
Yeah. So yes, this is you were going to say that because I needed to share this and talk about
the dangers of this. You know, we're talking about danger of forgetting our history. Mm-hmm. You know, the most grievous of it is us losing our identity.
Yes.
And how do we lose it? When we do not pass it from generation to generation. There was something that happened during the Syria war at the time. And what they did was that they started attacking all the monuments of Syria at the time. Why do you think they attacked the monuments of Syria? Not because it represented Syria, but it represented the people, the culture, the tradition. The moment you lose your culture, your tradition, your identity,
you become anything that anybody says that you are.
Imbibe it. And that is the problem we are currently facing in Nigeria today.
And you say and you're right.
It's not just in Nigeria, all over the world, Africa.
Yeah, all over the world. Let's not even forget that a lot of people lost themselves due to suffering. See, there's a level of pain you would go through that you will forget yourself. Anything that seems like good and hope to you is what you would take. And I feel like that's what happened to a lot of our parents and ancestors. Because there were things that they could not take anymore. And then, you know, let's even leave Africans, for example. Let's talk about the Black Americans.
Hmm.
Sometimes they forget that some of them are actually Africans.
They are waking up in some ways. But I get what you say. I guess what you say because sometimes, and we have even here, we do it. So you see someone become, I wanted to say a person of color because, you know, they're the ones colored now, but colored people.
We have lots of colors.
But I would say, for lack of a better adjective, a white person. So if a white person comes, you know, into the room, not this room, but mostly when you see people associate with whites, they feel that they are better than us.
Because they sold the mindset that they are superior
and
to us.
Exactly.
And we bought it.
And we should not forget that civilization actually began in Africa, in Egypt, to be specific.
I agree. But there is something that we still miss. During the slave.
We don't even learn about, I'm so sorry, but we don't even learn about that. We don't even learn about what makes Africa
so
great.
So important.
And I think that if Nelson Mandela did not suffer so much, maybe we would not know him too.
Now,
if he was not even celebrated in the within the international community, maybe as Africans, we wouldn't have forgotten about it.
Let's look back at literary poets and the likes of them, writers, okay? Back in the days, we had writers talking about issues that affected...
Like Ken Saro Wiwa,
like the Chinua Achebes, like, you know, the Wole Soyinkas, to name a few of them. The key thing is this, that today, we have writers talking about social issues and not continental issues.
But there's nothing wrong
identity.
About talking about social
I'm
issues.
Not disputing that. What I'm simply saying is how we lost ourselves in the cause of not recalling our history and knowing more about our history and where we are coming from. You know? So back in the days, we had poems like Africa, My Africa.
Yes.
You know, things like that.
They forced us to come.
Important Africa was at the time. So when you're standing, you're proud to be African. You're proud to be Black.
We recited those things proudly.
Totally.
Yes.
So, but today, what do we have? Shaky bum bum. We are losing our track. We've lost it along the way. Yes, Tupac Amaru Shakur, God bless his soul. I'm a Tupac girl.
Yeah.
And I love him because his poems were all about being better, about the African race, about the black race, about your identity.
You know, you're broaching a topic that I want us to probably maybe to talk more about because we're still going to break. Mm-hmm. When we come back from break, is how history and culture has influenced our arts, and the things to do. Because I think that somehow the music industry is playing a huge role in keeping that alive. But you know, they cannot actually do it alone.
Absolutely.
They can't actually do it because we need, and you know, the reason why I started from history being taught in schools is because people have to learn the things. And I did share the example with my daughter. We have to learn from the primary school, even from the nursery school.
Formally,
because they are learning about these things. They're learning about the Queen of England.
Absolutely.
And then when they touch on the Oba or they touch on the Igwe, it's just in the dress. Exactly.
You're clear. No
in the dress,
idea.
In nothing else. And meanwhile, a child that goes to primary school can list the family members of the Queen, telling you the progression. So there's really, really a lot that we have to do. Okay, so we will take a break. And when we return, this conversation just got interesting. So see you after the break.